email where Lana is stating that she is making the fact sheet more vague. And you're noted there as working on a second one, which I'm assuming was to be equally vague.
No, our list is online.
Your what?
Our host list.
Well, but what is that statement about? They reworded it to make it more vague.
I don't know.
Okay. I would suggest look into that, because we're going to make it a formal complaint.
I could ask her about that.
I mean, that would imply, I would think that Mr. Gates was writing the first draft of the fact sheet. Wasn't vague enough.
No. All right. Have you seen our host list?
Our host list
is very specific as to what trees are most stationed on the all the trees are.
But why would somebody on your staff be described making something more vague when developing a fact sheet? I mean, the words don't go together.
No.
Facts are facts, clarity is clarity. Vagueness is about...
We amended the list to add another specialist because that was golden rain tree.
So vague isn't something that should be using in the context of creating a fact sheet for a host species. Okay. So someone wasn't supervising Ms. Santos when she was making language more vague.
I will ask her.
Okay. That's good. We're also going to be filing a formal complaint because there's something that it would appear that there's a conspiracy between Ohio and the USDA to mislead the public when they're purposely creating vague factions.
I'm not sure what you mean by conspiracy.
Collaboration, conspiracy theory. But clearly, Rhonda didn't say, oh, by the way, your language is too vague, let me make it more clear. Her response was, let me make it more vague. That's not proper. A fact sheet should have clarity, not vague.
I've got to take the
That's what we have to write. So if this has been going on since November, how many other things that we haven't gotten a hold of through a Freedom of Information Act request? Your staff is making fact sheets more vague.
We don't fact sheets more vague.
What does that mean to you? Read that.
I'm going to have to ask her what her intention was.
I amended the host species language to be more vague. Now, that's not a typo. It sounds like it'd make more clear, more accurate, more better. It says more vague. So it would appear that we're being misled. I don't know. There's some evidence that says you guys are. We'll be investigating.
We're not misleading the public on the information that we put out there. We're not misleading
them. I find that hard to believe. I mean, we've got Dr. Phil over there.
Yeah. You can do it here, or you can type it in the email address.
Brendan Reardon's presentation state that, I think he was saying, treatment is 99.9% effective in eradicating the Asian woolworm beetle.
And treating trees that are not infested.
But then Clint, who's the guy up in Massachusetts, he stated that, oh, by the way, if the tree is infested, when the beetle does crawl out, if it crawls through the area that has the chemical treatment, they could die from that. And oh, by the way, the beetle in the next 72 hours before it can mate has to eat, and it's going to be eating leaves on that tree that it can have treated, and then probably going to die. Why isn't that good?
It could, but it also based on tree physiology, chemicals don't disperse throughout the tree evenly. So even if a tree is treated, the residue of one portion of the tree is not at the same level as another portion of the tree. And so beetle can feed on one section of the tree and not be exposed to chemicals. The chemical treatments are used in an area-wide approach for controlling any adult beetles that emerge from infested trees. On an area-wide approach, not an individual tree approach.
So it's important. work to control emerged adults from trees?
The chemical, if the beetle consumes enough chemical at a high enough density.
I understand, but I'm not just stating, the objective is to control emerged adults, to keep them from spreading.
Keep them from spreading. The chemical will also act on the first instar larvae as they feed right beneath the bark.
Right.
Because that's where the chemical is distributed.
Right, it's kind of beneath woods. Right.
Right. Yeah. So it works on both stages of the insects, those two stages.
But then how, like today, you're cutting in Bethel woods and you're not treating those trees, so any adult beetle that's on those trees is going to be flying away to find some other tree to infest, and you're basically spreading the Asian longhorn beetle when you cut during the summer.
If we leave trees standing, those trees will continue to produce beetles throughout the summer.
Well,
and the beetles will disperse.
What's in the guidelines that says it's warranted to do a bark spray?
You're referring to the emergency response guidelines.
No, it's the same guidelines that, I don't know.
Yeah.
It's these guidelines.
Yeah. New pest response.
And it says...
They're guidelines.
In here it says that it's warranted, if you're cutting a tree during adult emergence season, it's warranted to bark spray the tree to prevent the beetle from moving out and going elsewhere. Why aren't you doing that here?
We haven't done that in any of our locations.
Well, why not? It says it's warranted.
These are guidelines. These are optional tools for use.
Warned's a pretty strong word. It's not like it's sort of suggested. You ought to think about doing it. I mean, the reason...
You don't just say, I've got a
guideline. The word warranted is a little more strongly, but it's not even strongly suggested.
These are optional tools that program managers
can. And so why then is something not being considered like that? Why don't you...
It's not just a bark spray. It's actually a cover spray. So you would have to go in
and fog the tree with
chemicals.
Why do you want the beetle to spread? It's going to spread.
So why are you spreading the beetles?
The beetle, there are plenty of infestatrees that we haven't even detected yet. And even with our surveys, the visual surveys, we leave infestatrees behind. Our visual surveys are, at best, 60% effective in detecting infestatrees.
Or do you want to be more vague?
Sorry,
it's just, this has been a long haul.
Okay.
And we're not...
Let me clarify the April 1 date. The April 1 date had to do with the biological assessment that we had with Fish and Wildlife. In order for us to cut in this area, because there are Indiana bats in that section of Ohio.
Why do they say just April 1? What was the consequences of cutting it?
Because the Indiana bat starts the roost after April 1.
Okay.
And so since then we had to put additional procedures in place for monitoring so that we weren't impacting
Indiana bat was never discussed back in the day.
No, never was. What you said was that you weren't going to do this after April 1st because that is the emergence period.
Right, that's what we heard. April 1st was the emergence period, and your boys down at the MELA office, because you went in there, when you're going to have all this done by April 1st? And it comes out and says, yes. No one mentioned anything about bats and roostings
and
biological assessments.
And then you said they're not going to fly off the trees when they're cut down. That's cool. We've seen them. And so,
The credibility is really damaged, really, really damaged. I mean, either you need to learn how to get your facts and figures straight and say them right at the same time, rather than backpedaling into a statement that was never released anyway.
Yes. Our facts and figures are not made. I mean, all the information is out there. We made all the information available to the public.
After it's been vagarized by Ron DeSantis and Brad Gates.
I'm sorry that you feel that way.
Well, it's one of the things. I mean, it's blatant disregard for actually fulfilling the duty of your office. The creation of a fact sheet that should be clear and factual to the public.
Which fact sheets are you want some more information on?
I don't believe them. I don't believe anything that's in there anymore. I have no way of knowing how many other conversations Rhonda, you, and others have had about preparing any information that hasn't had the word, oh, let's make this a little more vague, or let's not mention this, let's keep this out of the press, let's not reinforce this. I mean, like, for example, in the environmental assessment, Brennan makes a point that, oh my gosh, we can't chemically treat because we only treated 137,000 trees in one state in one year. Well, on the flip side, when it's about you want to propose cutting down 1.3 million trees, you've never cut down more, I think, than 20,000 trees in a year. So if you can't chemically treat, because you only treated 137,000, what makes you think you can cut down 1.3 million trees?
We're not going to be able to, most likely not going to be able to do either in a year's time. This is a long-term program.
Right.
And it's taken, if you look at all the, when you look at Chicago, it took us 10 years to eradicate the infestation of Chicago. This is going to take probably at least that long here.
So why cut? Rather than, my understanding, if you chemically treat a tree, within 3 year time, it's clean. It should be clean. You're treating all the trees. And from what we understand with our research, it takes a two-person crew and chemically inject, pressure inject 90 trees in a day. Here's the point then. It takes a five-person crew. They can maybe cut down 15 trees in a day. In fact, the big ones we get on, it's lucky they can do one tree in a day. So if you can treat 90 in a day versus cutting 15, why not just chemically treat with pressure injections? You can get much more quickly through the whole process. You're not tearing up roads. You're not making people angry because you're turning stuff into mulch. You just chemically treat all day long. And then only take out what is truly infested. You can't cut all the time either because of rain conditions, weather conditions, all kinds of things going on. So chemical treatment, though, is a much quicker process.
And chemical treatments are used on trees that are not tested.
Right, but there is evidence because I'm sure chemical treatment has been used on trees that were really infested, but you didn't know they were, and they ended up killing the beetle that was already in that tree. That's correct.
If we find trees, even after we treated trees, we paid the dollars for treating those trees.
I'm going to cut them down because that's your protocol. But isn't it a scientific fact that chemically treating a tree can ultimately eradicate the beetle?
The information, when we're saying 99% effective, that's based on looking at trees throughout the New York area that we've done area-wide.
some does sneak through, but it can be pretty highly effective.
And these are on trees that are not pest tolerant.
Right.
These are on trees.
Right, that you couldn't tell if they were
pest. We didn't treat trees that we saw to be infested.
I've already said that it's very difficult to tell whether a tree is infested or not. So you were probably treating trees that were infested.
There is probably some trees that we treated with low levels.
The whole point is, if there was one lone maple tree left in the world and it was infested, could we not chemically treat it and save it?
Maybe.
Maybe. Right, what's the maybe behind it? That's the only tree left. And I'm putting injections into it.
You can chemically treat it, but whether it's gets saved or not, it's
what do you buy saved? How come it's not going to eradicate the beetle over a period of time? I'm injecting that tree every year for 3 years, and those holes, it's like a drill going in and coming out, those holes do close up. It takes 10, what did Dr. Orrick say how long it takes to kill a tree, for the beetle to kill a tree?
Well, our program experience has got a lot more experience in how long it takes to kill trees than the forest.
Because he had his trees walked into a smaller sample. You know, they were there for 10 years and he didn't find a single kill tree.
It's been in moisture for 10 years.
Pardon?
It's been in moisture for 10 years.
Well, that's what he studied. He stated in his paper that the trees that he studied had infestation for 10 years and he found no kill trees.
I have to go back.
Yeah, take a look at it.
I think that he was saying the beetle had been in moisture, not necessarily there in the study.
No, it was the trees he studied, they had been infested for 10 years, and he found no kill trees. So that's the other thing we got a problem with. It takes a long time for the beetles to kill a tree. So why don't we take a more gentle approach to battling the beetle rather than kind of this blinded, we just need to eradicate an invasive species as quickly as possible.
It's going to take time. Removing infested trees and multiple surveys that we're going to have to do and chemically treating trees,
it's going to take a long time. Isn't chemically treating quicker than cutting? And if not, why not?
Once you come in, you cut the tree, the beetles in it are gone.
Not if you're in a flat way during the summer, but
anything that's alive inside that tree is gone.
Once it's gone.
But if you've got large larvae, or sometimes a smaller larvae, or sometimes the beetles that are on the tree, you chemically treat it. You're not necessarily killing them. And the large larvae inside, you're probably killing them.
Can't you chemically treat it much more quickly than you can cut it down?
The physical act of treating a tree.
Treating a tree.
Yes, the physical act of treating a tree is
so
much faster.
Treating trees because it can be done much more quickly than cutting them all down.
Infested trees will come down. High risk trees, which are trees in proximity to infested trees, we're looking at alternatives for controlling the infestation here in Ohio. One of the alternatives we're looking at is chemical treatments.
But even if we went with alternative B, look, 20 years to do 1.3 million, how long is this going to take?
When you leave a tree standing with chemical treating, it's going to require multiple years of treatment.
Right.
It's going to require multiple times of surveying that tree to ensure that tree is not infested. So it's not just the fact of you're looking at how much time is it.
Right.
Physically, does it take to treat a tree versus taking a tree down? It's the multiple repeat activities that have to occur.
Really about making it easy for the USDA. Sure it is. I mean, so it's better for you to turn Claremont County into a wasteland by taking out 70% of the trees you proposed, than taking the time and energy. I know it's troubles. No?
And again, if we have the alternatives of removing coast trees, the high-risk coast trees being considered in the EA, as well as chemically treating high-risk coast trees, and they're all under consideration right now.
But why is it, but the logistics around the execution weren't considered at all? There's nothing in the EA that puts a time frame together that says we're going to remove 1.3 million stems and it's going to take X number of years. I mean, at the moment, you use the current rate you're on, it's going to take 94 years to catch up. So that means that if you're going to do it quickly, I'm guessing it was going to be 3 or 4 years, but you're saying 10 or more, I mean, you need to bring in 50 times the crews you have today. There's not, the Claremont County can't support that infrastructure. So why wasn't that looked at? I mean, how can you recommend something that, while in the realm of theoretical science makes sense, but in the realm of execution seems to be not based?
The only thing that we end up doing after this, when we go through the whole EA process, it is going to be dependent on the resources that we, that the program secures, right, to be able to have it done. Because all of it, no matter what happens, if you don't get the resources, if you don't get the funding to make it happen, we can't do it.
$1.3 million trees, 500 people working 5 days a week, 3 days, 3 months out of the year. April, May, June, 500 certified injectors could do it for $52 million. It costs $520 million to cut the same number of trees down. A little bit of a difference in it.
Places in the country are New Jersey, Massachusetts, Illinois, New York, it's in Toronto, Canada, and here.
Toronto, they paid the homeowners $300 per tree. I'm sorry to be. But they paid each homeowner $300 per tree. They cut them down.
They found like a real short-range pheromone. It doesn't produce long-range pheromones like, say, gypsy moth does. So the traps are pretty inefficient, very inefficient, actually.
When you see them in a tree, they live in the same tree. Did they go through a few cycles? Because it seems to be a relatively slow-moving vet.
We've been taught that they stay in that same tree. They keep coming back generation after generation to that same tree.
Not necessarily the same beetles. The same trees that have been attacked become more preferred by other beetles because they're stressed by virtue of being attacked.
There's a pheromone issue.
The tree produces chemicals that attracts the insects. Post plant volatiles.
How are you doing? All right. Well, far out
on this. And when it was feeding.
Do hackberries get shot hole borers?
Well, I mean, there's different caterpillars that feed on hackberry. I've never really seen big pest problems.
I mean, naiad caterpillars or anything I've seen feed on them, and fall webworm and spring tankerworms, but
yeah.
I mean, the internal feeding in between the veins doesn't look caterpillarish.
I can't really tell. I mean, one thing to look at it would be like a hand lens and see if the tissue's actually been eaten right there, or if it's been, sometimes frost damage kills a few cells, and then when the leaf expands.
Does the psyllid adult actually feed on it?
No.
So the psyllid adult doesn't eat anything.
It sucks.
It just screams and screams and howls.
Yeah. It just sucks sad.
You can go like this.
Yeah, I don't know.
Don't know. Want to take a look at that? It's not insect, though.
It's like diplodia.
Think so? I didn't see any.
Well, maybe not. Not with the needles turning green at the end. Spoke too fast.
I wouldn't have brought diplodia. Advancements in trapping or what?
This is a trap that's been used for longhorn beetles for a long, long time, and it's the best thing we've found so far for Asian longhorn beetles. We have it's been sort of a holy grail to find a good trap for this insect since the day we first found it in 96 in New York. They've done work, and they've found a number of compounds from maples that we know the beetle can sense, and maybe in the lab test look like an attractant, and then there's a couple of other compounds that are produced by the beetles themselves that act as aggregation pheromones that cause insects. At least in a lab setting, and if we put these in a lure, which we're looking at, we're hoping to get something for this trap somewhat beyond what just, you know, what happened for the beetles bumbling into it or saying, oh, there's something dark. Some researchers from Penn State came up with a particular blend we're using now, and they've had some luck with it. It's not like a gypsy moth trap where you put a pheromone strip in and you're covered with moths. They've had some luck with the indication that it will increase trap catch. And we tried it here last year, and it didn't. It was just, we got the same number of beetles and traps that were and were not beetles.
But what are the beetles?
Hoping by tweaking that a little bit.
What's the peak flight time in the day? Like EAB, 2 to 3 o'clock in the afternoon on a sunny day, you can look up and you see them flipping around. Is there a peak time for these? Are these morning movers or are these evening movers?
I get the impression it depends a little bit on weather. I mean, they're mostly daytime active, but in China, for example, where it gets real hot, they hunker down during the hottest parts of the day because they desiccate. Here, where it's more humid and maybe not so hot, they may fly all day.
Has this beetle been found in a terrain similar to Bethel? In that we're about a mile and a half, 2 miles from the river slope into the Ohio River, which I don't give a damn about sugar maple, but I don't want the erosion coming from the top of the hill running into the river. So I'm going to assume New York is pretty damn flat, Chicago's pretty flat, Toronto's pretty flat.
Worcester's got its own. Worcester's probably the closest we found to something like this. And also there's a mixture of more natural and, now we haven't seen any places with this much agriculture, but more natural and
different slopes.
But New York, Toronto, Chicago, those areas were primarily like urban suburban. So it's getting into more natural areas. There is a lot higher densities of trees. Here in Worcester, a little bit unique in that regard.
He's done a lot of testing about the Emerald Ash Borer. Do you test to see if these chemistries will work to kill the... do you have any studies that have shown why the imidacloprid does work?
Talking about mode of action or that kind of thing?
When the universities do all kinds of different ways, you know, they'll have different studies. So how much study have we done for this? I heard it was not very much here in the U.S.
Well, almost all the work that's been done in the U.S. has been, questions on that. It's been, ejecting trees, ejecting soil around trees, right? And looking at the resolution of the leaves and how well it gets into trees, distribution in trees, right, and that sort of stuff. In terms of effectiveness, in terms of actually killing the insects, most of that work's been done in China. Now, it's been done under, our people, it's not just Chinese research, purely.
We have staff over there testing.
Okay, it's not in there though. The lab studies are in here.
Yeah, but not all of them.
Well, it needs to be updated. Yeah. I have a complete meltdown every time anybody talks about American sycamore. I mean, there's no published science that I've been able to find that shows that ALB has gone through a life cycle.
When we first found it, it was a long-haired beetle in the United States. We did a number of studies in quarantine, and that was we exposed them to bolts of wood of different species and also the twigs to see if they feed on the twigs. Some of those were choice and non-choice studies. Those studies, at least the results, can only be taken so far. Are they?
So why would you choose to put some of them in the system and some of them not?
Some of them on it and some of them not.
Yeah, because some of
the lab finding results we have posted in there and some of them you don't.
When we follow up on that in China studies and open garden studies, we think those results are more indicative of what will happen in a natural setting versus a real artificial setting in a lab with a bowl of wood and
you know how many are.
I think we do, okay. And I'm going to have to check on that. I don't know. And I mean, we just took yellow birch and black birch.
Off the list?
No.
Oh,
no,
to China.
We took those to China this year because we have some lab results that aren't in there.
Okay.
And you know we're kind of will they ovipositive on it? Yeah. Will they survive on it?
Right.
We don't know.
So, it's just updated on February 1st, 2012.
Well,
I mean those results that we're unsure of.
Where would I find these results?
I can ask Cody White, the scientist that works on that, to get our lab.
I did a web page. Yeah.
If it says there's no U.S. record there for American,
and it doesn't say U.S. record, it says no.
Yeah.
But there's a lot that say no U.S. record. And since there's only this is where I took the exception. It's like you go through that, you read, and say, okay, I understand.
Let's pull the tables together now. Just let me hang out there. So Brian is on his way over. There's not a gun.
But if you go into no record of any sycamore having any ALB, and you're telling me you're going to take away all these beautiful sycamores, and you're taking away 70% of all my trees anymore, I'm going to go, no, you're not.
Sure, no, I can see that. And I'll tell you, when we are sure, or we're fairly sure, that something isn't going to act as a host, we recommend to take that off the host list. We recommend that they take Celtis off the host list.
You've recommended it, but they haven't done it.
Well, they're doing it. And I mean, the program's not stupid because they don't want to survey hackberry, they don't want to treat hackberry, they don't want to cut down hackberry. They don't have to.
If they don't have
to. Well,
because it's going to cost them money. But we've looked at Celtis here. There was one record in Chicago that was never confirmed because we never got the beetle out of the tree. We've got it in China, both our Orient Celtis and our American Celtis. And our recommendation is now forget about Celtis.
Okay.
You know, it's not a
problem. I think they're still surveying it as a precaution, but they're not.
Oh, there's a lot of Celtis around. But I don't want to say take something off the list if we're not sure. Because if we leave a reservoir.
But I don't want you to cut it down.
Oh, I agree. I agree.
I would rather leave it standing and go, okay, watch for overposition.
That's right. Let's watch this for the next couple of years. Yeah, instead of cutting it down and saying, oh, that was the easy way.
It's probably different than your personal
opinion. You've never seen the overposition on America.
No, okay. I'm sorry. I'll watch
that's interesting.
And they're like, well, we're on our own here. They're like, we can't help you try to get out. So at that point, you know, we've all completely just, I almost lost my mind, but we've been working through it with the help of our community. But they're not going to come back in the woods and create the same problems. They can't do that.
Just
Beth, well, there's nothing marked yet, but they haven't come back to mark since July, so I'm sure there are. I mean, we've almost, our whole property, I mean, so we're probably doing something. But we have all those problems. So I assume they'll come back, and I just want to prevent this.
Especially, especially that core area.
Yeah, well,
we come back and resurvey.
I don't know. Like, when we first started, I didn't ask for, I mean, they started cutting. We were at work, we took down 40 trees in one day, they were just lying there. I didn't get a chance to ask for proof of infestation. From what I could see, there were some bad sites. I couldn't find any exposed of any of our trees that came down. So they weren't heavily infested. I do have questions whether everything was infested, you know, and they're gone. They've been fixing our fence for
Until they're actively emerging.
And so whether the trees stay
cutting it into bits and pieces, those bugs are going to get caught. One of them hit my windshield flying on the way over here.
Are there the trees standing or are the trees cut? Those beetles are going to emerge.
Okay.
If it's time for the beetle to emerge, it's going to emerge regardless if the tree is standing or if the tree is cut.
Okay, I don't agree with that, but that still doesn't make it okay that it was brought over and marked against the fence where there was healthy trees there. None of those trees were marked, and they're bringing a big bunch of infested wood lined up against healthy trees. It's spread by nobody's.
It's time for the beetles cutting
That's not a problem. Can you speak up?
We can't hear you.
I was just informing Phil about what the conversation has been about so that he could respond to some of the questions that are coming.
Okay.
It's endangering our non-infested trees.
I guess my question is, if plan A doesn't pan out, if a piece of equipment breaks, why is there no plan B? Friday when the contractors were going to break down, they couldn't move that last pile of wood.
So I wasn't made aware of that issue.
Then perhaps you should sanction your tree cutters or hold them accountable or fire.
But there was a USDA man on site, Ryan.
Somebody knew about it.
Who should have been going to somebody.
They had him go pick it up and hide it. Somebody knew about it before Monday.
So who made the call for them to go clean it up on Father's Day?
I don't know.
Whoever was monitoring the Facebook page, whoever that might be,
the other question we have.
They may have been monitoring themselves.
Who, the subcontractors?
Could be. Is the chipper coming in on Saturday?
So that could be.
What's your question?
The chipper.
Yeah? At the marshalling yard?
Yes,
they're there on Saturday.
And when did that start? What Saturday did that start? Does that start this next Saturday, or did that start this past Saturday?
You're asking about operations at the marshalling yard?
Yes, we're talking about the 24-hour. We're talking about cutting the trees that are during the emergence period now within 24 hours of the time that they're cut.
I don't think that's what you're asking.
No, she's asking you why weren't the trees cut this past Saturday, that we have documentation of the pictures from the yard that are still sitting there on Sunday morning.
So if the grinder was there, the pile should be gone.
The grinder wasn't. They're saying to check that.
The marshalling yard is open on Saturdays.
But you're not answering the question.
It's open without the chipper.
I guess I don't understand the question. The chipper is at the marshalling yard.
Okay, well,
is it being used?
The chipper is not at the marshalling yard.
This weekend
it is not there over the weekend. Why would the
tub grinder?
Yeah.
The tub grinder is gone. They move the tub grinder out every Friday afternoon or Friday evening because we were told by you, your previous guy, that they pay money to rent that tub grinder, so they're not going to rent it on the weekend if they don't have to.
Yeah, but that changed because once at the end of May, told the contractor was having the 48-hour shipping requirement.
Your documents still say 24 hours because I just printed it off.
And so we require the contractor to have them bring their chipper or have their chipper stay through Saturday so that they can ship on Saturday so that we don't have wood sitting for more than 48 hours.
But I have documentation. I have pictures, Christine. I was there on Saturday. Those trees were still there on Monday morning. It's not being done.
So we need to follow up on it. It's not being done.
And what do they do? Bring the grinder in on Saturday and take it out Saturday afternoon?
If it's not being done, we have to follow up. Because to our knowledge, it's being done.
But that's the big communication breakdown. USDA isn't holding Young's accountable.
Young's is barely holding their subcontractors responsible. And
so they're getting away with it, all kinds of stuff like that. I mean, this weekend's a perfect example. Where was the USDA people? If it broke down, nobody from USDA could step in and say, oh, use this equipment. Really?
Now, here's a question I have for you. Me and you, the three of us stood there in that ground, and you said to me it was a mechanical failure that was the reason that those trees were stuck in the middle of that woodlot where the walk trails are. You said to me, mechanical failure. Did you not?
The truck broke down.
Yeah, you said truck broke down. Okay. Why would you tell Melissa Kirscher that accidents happen? What did that mean?
I'm not sure what you're referring to.
Because Melissa Kirscher claims you told her when she asked you about the woodpile and the walk trails, Melissa Kirscher claims you said accidents will happen. What does that mean?
So it sounds like you're asking about two different things.
No, I'm asking why there's two different statements out there is what I'm asking.
We told her that there was a truck broke down, the reason why they couldn't come in, and all that last.
Well, then did you?
They do have other trucks.
That could have been brought in. They just didn't bring it. That ain't answer.
It wasn't done.
Right. And then it was parked back up against a tree or a fence full of trees. See? And there? All the trees. We are losing our trees in the village of Bethel and in Tate Township at an alarming rate. And you're telling me that there's no plan B. You're telling me that communication broke down. That is not an excuse. In the world where I come from, that is not an excuse.
I mean, even though those trees, those cut trees, the risk to, there's no higher risk for those trees spreading potential beetles.
Yes,
no, there isn't. It's spreading potential beetles. Trees that are standing, because there's still infested trees standing in that location.
Nancy McCarthy,
is no
I understand that. But the more
bring Nancy over here,
the more chance there is for those beetles to go to another tree.
It's going to take many, many years for us to eradicate some infested trees. You're going to see infested trees for many, many
years. She had infested trees on her property for years, and they never left those couple of trees until Duke came and trimmed branches, and it spread it just like it was spreading up there. You can't tell me that cutting it up into little pieces isn't pushing those bugs out all over the place. Otherwise, why would the cut period be usually April 1st before emergence? But after that, you're supposed to chemically treat first, which you're not.
No, we have.
That's what it says on your website.
We've successfully eradicated Asian longhorn beetles from Chicago, from Jersey City, from Iceland, New York, without cover sprays. And we cut trees in every one of those locations all year round. These are just
also treated with them into Cooperative, hundreds of thousands of trees in the city areas. You've treated with imidacloprid the hundreds of thousands of trees with injections or soil treatments in the same areas.
Not at first. When we started out with the eradication activities in New York, we didn't start using chemical treatments, and that was on a very limited basis until 2001.
Right, but
so we were surveying trees and removing infested trees from 1996 through 2001 without any chemical treatments.
And I understand that you've cut from Illinois less than 2,000 trees to eradicate it from that area. I mean, they're not apples to apples. We're talking about rural area and a concrete.
There weren't as many infested trees there.
Right, exactly. But
you're using that science for here, which is we have different 20,000 trees in Massachusetts.
And you have 4 years of, the math works
out. It's taken us a long time there. That infested area is 110 square miles. Your infested area here is 56 square miles.
Christine,
a lot of trees.
Can I just real quick make an introduction? This is our attorney,
Brian O'Connell.
Hi, Brian.
to meet you in person.
Nice to meet you too.
I guess I must be the lawyer. I think I'm.
Yeah, I know.
He's the suit.
Stand out.
And you're Phil.
Phil Mulder.
Nice to meet you, Phil.
Could I, Bill, nice to meet you too.
Could I make a suggestion in about 10 minutes when all of the majority of the general public have gone? Can we pull these tables together in the middle of this room and all of us stakeholders sit down across from each other at a table and talk this thing out?
I'm not sure what you want to talk about.
I think our main concern is we want to talk about the needs on the part of the screen and trying to understand why the guidelines aren't being followed and we talk about the situations. Maybe we just talk that out.
If it's in your science, it's in your science for a reason, because it had to have worked at some point, right?
You never
so
used
if it worked,
it.
You've never used
We've
it,
never
but
used
you
it.
Have it in the guidelines to
use. These are, they're guidelines, and there may be circumstances. You have to bring, and it's not just bark sprays. These are cover sprays. In order for that to knock down an adult beetle population, you would have to come in and fog that entire tree, the entire canopy, the entire tree. You would have pesticide all over, and probably pesticide drift. We're just not going to do that, because the risk that you have to the community, you have chemical, you can't just target that particular tree. You're going to have chemical drifting across the neighborhood. We're not going to do that.
In the guideline, though, it is specific bark spray. I mean, that's what
it's that's cover what it spray. Talks it's covered in order to it, in order it, to kill.
Bark spray prior to removal is warranted.
Is warranted.
It's warranted. Do you
it's
know
cover spray? We can bring the scientists to talk about the chemical.
Okay,
that's
what I was.
These trucks here were sitting behind the school parking lot where 1, 2, 3 trucks loaded up with stuff that should have gone over the marshaling yard on Friday. And on Sunday, they're still left over at the walking trail. I'm sure you heard about that. And then the crew scrambled on Father's Day morning in the pouring down rain and put them in the trucks with no USDA oversight. And then they were hidden over here, not taken to the marshaling yard. These apartments right there, and only one of the three of the trucks were actually bungee property. They stayed there for the rest of the weekend. And they drove through Bethel, past the McDonald's. There's three trucks right there. And this was at 9:10. This is at 8:50 in the morning. Right, 9:50 in the morning. This is at 10:10, driving through Bethel. That, my understanding is, the requirement is that they're shredded within 24 hours.
Are you doing this? You're providing that to us?
Yeah.
So that we can follow up.
And you're kind of further on up the ladder, aren't you? Okay, this is
things
public
like this together.
Why aren't they being reprimanded for this?
Can you find out?
I do not know the specifics about this. I have not been told what's going on, what happened here. This is a contractor truck. And so as far as what happened on Sunday, I don't know.
Okay, but as I say, if it was me, in my business, I'd be fired for spreading the ALB, all over these apartments. Driving down the road, I'd be in all kinds of trouble if I didn't have a USDA or ODA official there when I'm throwing this stuff on in the rain. Gosh, you're supposed to have oversight, and there's no oversight. I'd be really upset with them. Instead of everybody here getting upset with them, we're just standing around here telling us, go talk to them, go talk to them. Please, it's like ping pong misinformation.
There's
misinformation.
Contractor issue, and Phil is the one that can address it.
Alright, I already talked to Phil about it. And so Young is going to get off scot-free with this. And they're allowed to violate your contract with you, I guess, is the way it sounds.
Or we'll just fire another subcontractor. It's their fault.
Did you still want to try to speak?
I'll talk to him.
That answer was vague for me.
He told me that there is a 2011 guideline, pest guidelines for
we don't have a 2011. So we're in the process.
That, but that's what she said she was told for her. For the reason for
when
all that
she asked you, when she asked you about the 2008,
no, we didn't. We didn't say that. We said that we're in the process of looking at it because they need to be updated. We told her they need to be updated.
Okay.
We're working on that now. It's not even ready for to go out for public comment.
We did. 08 was what's referenced in the EA.
No, you're not missing because we don't have an update. You're not missing anything. What they're referencing is the 2000.
Well, I don't know where Melissa got that. So I guess my question is, there's the superintendent of our school, PhD superintendent of our schools saying one thing, and two members of the government saying another.
Yeah, well,
I don't know, I'm kind of leaning, I don't have to tell you where I'm leaning here.
Leaning to Melissa.
Okay, I think that's probably a really good idea. Maybe I'll give Missy a call tomorrow and have her give you a call back and see if we can get a good about what it's 2011.
I think it might be helpful to talk about this in the sense that this is we're all on the same page. I just don't think there's any competing interests.
I think that after a long night like tonight, though, this is not the night to do it after a long day.
Don't we have another hour or so? Half
hour. It's easier to sit.
And I got to tell you, Willie, you may not have been at the one in November, but they tried to do the same thing there, and they tried to shut it down on time. But you know what? We don't have to go anywhere, and you're hired by us. So if we decide this thing needs to run a little bit later, I think you owe that to us, don't you think?
I don't think that there's anything to be gained from meeting tonight after a long day. So I think that we can sit down tomorrow or something.
You don't think it would be more productive while everybody's already here to sit down and speak where everybody could hear everyone's comments instead of a little piece here and a little piece there?
It's been a long day. And y'all really
any day that we have a meeting in the evening is a long day because all of us work.
And let me tell you,
4 o'clock was not a real great time.
It's been even longer. Even longer has been the 8 months since the last time we met on November 1st. That's what's been long. This, today, is a piece of cake. So I think we need to get together. I think we need to sit across the table from each other, and let's just discuss a bunch of stuff. Let's go a half an hour or something. Let's set a time.
I agree. I don't think that's a nice thing.
Why not?
We would love to sit down with you.
To me, this is the most ridiculous format that anybody ever.
What is your status with APHIS? What are you?
I'm the Senior Regional Program Manager.
What does that mean? Just what does that mean?
Are you his boss?
No, sir. I'm not his direct boss.
Well, you know, let's try to be proactive here and constructive. I mean, if you guys are available tomorrow, I am. We can maybe pull out a handful of us, maybe we need. One time I knew that some of you folks had met.
We have a venue, right?
Well, no, but I know. I think if we can.
Do we have another half hour already?
You have 24 minutes to do that.
Well, can you do it now?
The meeting now.
They're here to answer questions. What time you folks head back to Washington tomorrow?
Yeah, I can make my arrangements to stay as long as I want to. So if we need to do it tomorrow evening or something, I'm willing to do that.
Let me talk with the folks here. That might be best. Because, you know, I want to be respectful. If you've had a long day, if you've had to travel, you know, I think everybody's best when they're sharp and rested. Maybe tomorrow night's better.
We certainly want to address your concerns. I'm just thinking, you know, there's a time and a place to do it. Maybe tonight is not the time.
Let's look at that. Let's look at that. Scare Christine off?
No, she was needed elsewhere.
around the Cayman Rescue.
Well, let me go see if I can talk to her, because I wanted to talk with her about this. It might be better than private conversation.